By what name are you known?
There are some who call me Tim.
Welcome to another episode of Timmy Talks, the channel where we talk old school magic. And the reason I'm saying old kind of spooky is because this whole week is going to be Halloween themed. So the matches that you'll see today and also the match that you'll see this Friday will be Halloween themed. And I have a little surprise coming up on Thursday. But okay, that's all for the future. For now, I'm playing against Park Goldfield, a player from LA who also alters his decks. And I follow him on Instagram and he posted a picture of this just fantastic looking Halloween deck. And I'll show it to you in a moment in Deck Tech. And it's just beautiful. And I'm playing against this with my wall deck that you saw earlier this week. I believe I posted it on Friday. If you'd like to go directly to the matches, you can click on the timestamp below. For now, I'm going to go through both of these decks, starting with the deck of Park Goldfield. And I can advise you, I would advise you to stay and look at this deck because it's something special. The first deck that I would like to look at is the Halloween deck by Park Goldfield. So this player from Los Angeles. And here it is, here you see the picture, and probably first thing you notice is the altars in this deck, and that's actually what made me want to invite him to play with it here on the channel, you know, besides the fact that I just, you know, love playing Magic, but seeing these altars I think makes it a really special Halloween deck. So let's take a look at another picture where we can see some of the figures in close-up. So you see the Priests of Yawgmoth, and they are turned into Dracula, Frankenstein's monster, the Invisible Man, and the Phantom of the Opera. And they're the ones on the right side, the playset on the right side. Then you have the playset on the left side, the Initiates of the Ebon Hand. And they each have a classic movie poster theme. So you've got the Bride of Frankenstein. They're holding the posters. It's really nicely made. I really like it. So they've got the Bride of Frankenstein, the Spider, the Mummy, and the Wolfman. And here at Park Goldfield says that they have been renamed as the classic horror movie fans. So it's pretty cool. And then we have four cards at the bottom. And I'm just looking at the notes that Park Goldfield gave me. And it's here. It says Fallen Angel, the card on the left, is the Bride of Frankenstein. Then next to it, you've got Bogwrath, and that's the creature from the Black Lagoon. And next to that, we've got the Hunchback of the Notre Dame, and that's the Xenic Poltergeist. And also nice, look at the, what's her name again? The girl, Esmeralda, that's her name. So the girl is on the picture as well. And then Yawgmoth Demon is turned into Nosferatu. Very, very cool altars. But besides these altars, there's also an idea behind this deck. And there's one combo specifically that I would like to point out. And I've put all the cards together here. And this is basically what I'm hoping for looking at Park's deck. Because what you see here is a Mana Vault and a Suchi. And Initiates of the Ebon Hand, Priest of Yawgmoth. And then the final step in this combo is the Drain Life. So it's pretty insane, but it could actually work. Who knows? He's playing against the wall deck. I'm gonna give him tons of time. So he's gonna tap his Mana Vault, then make the three colorless mana into three swamp because of the Initiates of the Ebon Hand. So you can make colorless mana into swamp, or yeah, that's basically what you can do. Then you see a Suchi. Well, what Priest of Yawgmoth does, you can tap it to add any amount of black mana to your mana pool equal to the casting cost of an artifact, but you have to sacrifice the artifact. So he's going to use the Priest of Yawgmoth to sacrifice Suchi, gaining 4 black mana, but when Suchi dies you also get 4 colorless mana. So you can use that mana and use the Initiates of the Ebon Hand to make that into black mana. So this means if you do a little sum, you get 4 mana from the Priest of Yawgmoth, 4 mana from the Suchi is 8, you get 3 mana from the Mana Vault, that's 11. With the Initiates, you can make it all into black mana, swamp, so you've got 11 swamp. Then you can play out a huge drain life, and bam, you know, you've just halved your opponent's life total. Well, almost, but I just assume you also have a swamp or two on the battlefield. So this could be very powerful. You do need 5 pieces, but still, it could work. Another thing that he can do is he can use Howl from Beyond. And one of the reasons I really like Howl from Beyond is the fact that it's an instant. So it works together very well with Suchi. What you see often is that you attack with a Suchi and another creature, or with two Suchis, and your opponent disenchants one of them, and you cannot use the 4 colorless mana because you need to have some kind of fast effect or instant spell. Now, because of Howl from Beyond being an instant, you can actually use those 4 mana to pump your other creatures. So again, I think there's some nice synergy going on there. Now, obviously, there are more synergies in this deck. You know, there are reasons why the Fallen Angel is in there, the Yawgmoth Demon is in there. I also see the Anime Debt working together really well with the disc. You blow up everything and then you steal the best creature of your opponent. That's something that I did in the past too, and it's a lot of fun to do, I can tell you. So it is a fun deck, but there are also some really nice mechanics. So I look forward to kind of seeing that come back into this match. So this is the flavorful deck of Pargofield, the Halloween deck. And now let's have a look at my deck. I am playing with a Waltz deck, and we've seen this deck before. I actually posted it a match with this deck on Friday, so there's just going to be an info card appearing right now. If you'd like to see more, if you'd like to see a deck with more details than this deck, because I'm just going to keep it short, then you can click on the info card and it'll take you to that match and you'll see more details about this deck. Now, the interesting thing is I've actually updated the deck, so this picture is not completely accurate anymore. What I've done, I've added a Wrath of God because I felt like I needed some more removal in this deck. And also it works great with activating the Sword of the Ages and play a Wrath of God after that. And I've also added a Resurrection to kind of get back my Akron Legionnaire, because I noticed that every time I cast the Akron Legionnaire, people want to get rid of it. So I thought maybe it's nice to or play the Akron with just my untapped swords on the battlefield, or when I play the Akron Legionnaire, have a Resurrection to get it back, you know, just as a backup, or also after activating the sword. Basically, the idea of this deck, for the people that haven't seen this deck in action yet, the idea is that I play a lot of walls and I play Fortified Area to give extra power to those walls, and then I play a Sword of the Ages, and I kind of activate my Sword of the Ages. And what Sword of the Ages does, it says you can sacrifice X amount of X creatures, and then it deals damage to any target equal to the power of all those creatures combined. So if I have a lot of walls, and those walls together have like 15 power, I can all sack them to the sword and deal 15 damage to my opponent. Now, obviously, I'm hoping to just deal 20 in one go, but I've put in multiple swords, and you can also see, for instance, a Righteousness, so the dream is still to have a sword in play, my opponent is gonna attack, I'm gonna block, use my Righteousness, and then kill his creature, and then also use my Sword of the Ages to deal tons of damage. So that's basically the deck, like a very short version. So if you wanna see a longer deck video on this specific deck, you can click on the info card that's on the screen, and it'll take you to that match where I go more into depth in this particular deck. So for now, let's see if my walls can protect me from the monster army of Pargofield. Let's go to game number one. Game number one, and it is Park on the play here, playing a basic swamp. He's playing with the deck Halloween Party, and I'm playing with my Brick in the Wall deck sitting on the right here, playing a Lantex turn one, passing turn. So that's a good start for me. And if Park plays a land, decides to, I can activate my Lantex next turn. So he's playing a Mishra's Factory. It's not playing a creature. So that means I can activate my Lantex on Ding for 3 basic planes. And shuffling my deck again. And I hope to see some of those really nice alters that Pargofield has made in his deck. I guess we're already seeing one that's the dragon there. Though I wonder if that's his altar or a Dan Frazier. And there we see a wall of Keltrops, the 2-1 wall from Legends for 1 white and 1. And when it blocks, it can band with other walls. And I think we're kind of discussing the art right now. Because when you see the wall from a distance, you might think that the soldier is the wall, but it's actually the Keltrops that are drawn there on the bottom that the soldier is stepping on. And it's a pretty neat little picture. Well, look at that. There's a Black Lotus here from Park. So another swamp. So he has a lot of mana now available. And will we see something like a Suchi or another big creature? Ooh, this is nice. There's a Chaos Orb. And he's going to flip it on the Lantex. So let's put it in slow-mo. So let's see if Park can hit my Lantex here. I think it's a good decision to get rid of it. Definitely a dangerous card here, and that's a nice flip, full hit, not the best angle, but a good flip, and the Lantex is gone. I play with a full playset though, so I'm sure I'll maybe find another one, still having three in my deck. And he's passing turn. And I'm playing a basic plains here, tapping for three, playing a fortified area. And that means that my Wall of Caltrops is getting plus one, plus zero, and banding. So it's now a 3-1 wall. And I'm passing turn. Another Mishra's Factory. But I don't think that Park will attack, because why would he trade his factory for a Wall of Caltrops? And there he goes, playing a Demonic Tutor. And I hope he's not going to look up a Mind Twist. That would be the obvious choice, but I kind of have the feeling that with these flavorful games, maybe he's going for something else, something more spicy. Playing another Basic Plains. And putting an Animate Wall on my Wall of Caltrops, attacking. And that's the nice thing, because I don't really mind trading it. Animating his Mishra's Factory, blocking with it, and there's a Disenchant from my side. And I do that before blockers are declared, but upon activation. So that means that Park still gets a 3 damage, going down to 17. And it's just great to attack with like an Animated Wall. It's like, it's a really good feeling. And here is a Disc, and that's a pretty good decision, because I have much more on the board going for me right now. Playing another Basic Plains, playing a Mox Pearl, not really caring about the Disc, it seems. And this is why playing a Divine Offering, that means 4 life for me, and that's one of the changes I've made in my deck. I've taken out the Dust to Dust main board and replaced it with a Divine Offering and put the Dust to Dust in my sideboard. Attacking now for 5, and that's some serious damage here that Park's taking, going to 12 life. And playing a Plains, so he does have 5 mana now, he does have 5 mana now, so I'm kind of waiting for him to play out a Suchi or something else, because I've already used a Disenchant and a Divine Offering, so there's not that much artifact removal in my deck left. So when he would play a Suchi, it probably stays on the board. And I wonder if I'm gonna attack now. I decide not to. Pass turn instead. And there's land number 6 here from Park. Is he going to play out a Yawgmoth Demon? Well, he doesn't have anything to sacrifice. Look, this is interesting, playing a Drain Life. I think that's a good move. Drain Life for just 1 is killing my Wall of Caltrop. And he's passing turn. Tapping for 4 here. Is there a Wall of Swords? Oh, there's a Primal Clay. Nice. And this is always difficult to see, because I can't remember what I chose it to be. I need to find some kind of system that I can show it on the camera. I think I've made it into a 2-2 flyer or a 1. Yeah, I can't remember. So we'll just have to see. If I attack with it, it's probably a 2-2 flyer. And there's another Mishra's Factory here by Park Goldfield. That means it's Mishra's Factory number 4 that he's playing out. And he's lost 1 to 1 of my Disenchants. But this I can get into serious trouble here. Remember, if I made it a wall, and it's kind of annoying that I don't know, then my Primal Clay is a 1-6 wall with banding. But since he's attacking, I don't think I've done that. Oh, and look at that, a Howl from Beyond for... Is that just for 1? Let's see how much damage I'm taking. A Howl from Beyond for 5, so that means I take 7 damage. Anyway, I'm on 18. Oh, of course, he needed 1 basic land to activate his factory, so that means I've taken 6 damage and it wasn't 24. Okay. Attacking with both here, so I guess it is a 2-2 flyer. Park is going to 9 lives now. To be honest, I don't think making it into a 2-2 flyer was the best decision. Because of that fortified area, my 1-6 wall would have turned into a 2-6 with banding, kind of making it possible for me to kill his factories if he would attack. Look at that, there's a Suchi. Ay, 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 and this is a problem. Okay, I still have a Disenchant in hand, so I guess I was keeping that interesting, or maybe I just drew it and I've got a sorts here. Taking care of the factory upon activation. It does mean that he's gaining 3 life, exactly, and he's going back to 12. But I have an open road again to dealing some damage. But he still has 2 Mishra's factories left. And as you can see in the build, I've decided to put a Swords to Plowshares in instead of one of my Spirit Links. Attacking now for 4. That means he's going to 8 life. And passing turn. It would be nice if I could draw like a wall of sorts to kind of block those Mishra's factories or some other wall. And look at this. A disc now. And I've already used up 2 disenchants and a divine offering. Attacking. Going to 6 here. Having to pass turn. That means that he can activate the disc. And look at that. I'm losing a lot here. At least I'm still on 18, so I have some time to find answers. Oh, this is nice. Playing an anime debt. Brilliant. Well played here. Getting a 3-4. Suchi. And remember, I hardly have any artifact and enchantment removal left in my deck. Playing a resurrection on my primal clay. And I believe this time I am making it into a 1-6 wall. And passing turn. And he's just going to swing in. Makes sense. So I'm probably going to block the Suchi here and take 4 damage. And that's exactly what I do. So I'm on 14 life. Playing another Mishra's Factory. So a lot of factories in this game. Attacking for 2 here. Bumping to 3. That means he goes to just 3 life. Playing a Spirit Link on his Suchi. Very interesting game. And there's the Priest of Yawgmoth. And that allows him to sacrifice a creature and get black mana in return. And this is the Invisible Man altar. And boy, those altars look very cool. So of course the synergy here is that he can use the Priest to sacrifice his Suchi. Gain, I believe, 4 black mana, and then also gain the 4 colorless bonus from the Suchi. So he just gets a lot of mana. And if you combine that with a Howl from Beyond or another X-Spell, it can work really well. And look at that, my Sword of the Ages. That means that next turn, Park is dead unless he can find a way to get rid of that sword. Because I can activate the sword now, first animate my factories. So that's what I'm... No, that's not what I'm doing. Interesting. Oh, I'm playing a double fortified area and then I'm sacking my wall. And that means that I deal exactly 3 damage. Ooh, this was a very close match. Wow. Because I kind of felt Park was getting back into it there. Very cool game number 1. We're going to go to our sideboards. And then I'll see you back at game number 2. Game number 2. And after winning that first one, I guess Park is on the play again. Although with my Lantex deck, I think I'll choose to be on the play rather than on the draw. It's some advice I got when testing with this deck. And there is a basic swamp here by Park, passing turn here. Tapping in planes, playing it at Lantex again. And playing at Mishra's Factory. So far it's very similar to game 1. Ooh, but there is a Demonic Tutor. I wonder what he's going to look up. Maybe an answer for the Lantex? Or maybe a card from the sideboard? Or maybe now he is choosing to go for that mind twist. I do believe it's in the deck. Look at that playing. Oh, playing a Gloom. Using the Black Lotus, sacking it for the Gloom. And of course, that's a problem. I'm playing with a lot of white. At least I get to activate my land tax to find a lot of mana to kind of work around the Gloom. The Gloom is an enchantment that basically says that you have to pay three more for each white spell that you want to cast. And that's the relevant part of Gloom in this matchup. So that's a problem for me here, playing a Mishra's Factory. So both of these games full of factories so far. Wanting to tap two land, but decide not to. Okay, I do. And there is maybe my answer for that Gloom, playing a Chaos Orb. Of course, I have no mana left anymore to activate it. I have to admit it's always nice when I'm playing against black that I don't have to be afraid for any instant artifact removal. Like there's no disenchant or shatter in the color black. And there we see one of those altered cards. And that's the Fallen Empire 1-1 that can actually turn colorless mana into swamp. So it's really nice to use that with a Drain Life combination. And again, using my Lantex. And I think I need to go on the... Oh, look at that. A flip. Let's first focus on the flip here. Gonna choose the Gloom. Bam! And that's a nice hit. And that means that the Gloom's gone. But what I wanted to say is I think I need to go on the Lantex for Dummies school. Or if there's a book, read the book. Because again, I'm not showing the basic lands that I'm picking up. So I really need to kind of get used to playing with that card. There's a third Mishra's Factory here. And again, Park is really finding those factories. Game one, he had a full playset. And this game, he already has three of the four on the board. There is a Suchi. And again, I'm activating my Lantex. And what am I going to do? Playing at Plains. And of course, I'm looking for an answer to deal with that Suchi. Although I'm still on 18. Finding a Spirit Link here. So that's going to do it for now. Playing that on the Suchi. And casting another Wall of Keltrops. So now they can band with each other. Because one of the abilities of Wall of Keltrops is that you can band it with other walls. And there's a Strip Mine. That's, ooh, he's not going to use it. Instead, oh, using a Mind Twist. Brutal. Oh, that means I only get to keep three cards, I think. Oh, we were having... Oh, yeah, I remember this. We had some communication issues with deciding what cards I could keep. Let's look at what I'm going to discard. Wall of Swords would have been super handy. I'm reshuffling it. Okay. Yeah, we had some issues with kind of trying to figure out what's what. I guess I should have just numbered them. But you know how it goes sometimes when you play over a webcam game. So he's, oh, that's nice, hitting his Sword of the Ages there, and he's finding a Righteousness. In that perspective, I'm actually kind of doubting if I should still play with Spirit Link, because playing with Spirit Link is not really inviting your opponent to attack and being able to use the Righteousness. So I'm not all too happy with how the Spirit Link is performing. In a way, it's doing its work, but it's also blocking the Righteousness. So maybe if you're watching this and you're hearing me commenting on this and you have an idea, please leave it in the comments. I'm curious to hear about your opinion on this. Anyhow, I have very little cards left, and there's probably a lot of basic lands in my hand, playing another Mishra's Factory. Paying four, so there's that Wall of Swords that we saw earlier. So at least I have that one still. And remember, the Wall of Keltrops can now band, so I can now band together in a huge... make it one huge wall. and he's using a strip, and I just strip a factory, and then I can decide to deal the damage any way I want to, so to make sure that nothing on my side dies. So that makes it very unfavorable for Park to attack here. He's kind of stuck against his wall opposition. But of course, that mind twist is always brutal. Losing a righteousness and losing a sword. I think the sword is the most important part. And there's a fortified area, because look at this. If I can find a sword, then I already have each wall of Keltrop now has a power of 3. So that's 6. Got my wall of sword has 4. That's already 10 damage on the board. And also my factory that I can animate. That means 12 damage on the board. But remember, Park is still on 20. I haven't dealt him a single damage this game. So finding an animate wall now, for instance, to animate my wall of swords and kind of fly over his Suchi would be fantastic. And I'm still playing out plays like there's no tomorrow, but I'm not sure if that's a good decision. Playing another wall of swords here. So if I find that sword, wow. Because I now have 6 lands and my opponent has 6. That means I cannot activate land tax anymore. And look at that, I'm still activating it, but I'm changing my mind. Park is pointing it out to me. So I just want to look back at these matches, how I play with Lantex. I'm a little bit annoyed with myself. But hopefully as I play more and more games with this deck, I can use it the way it's intended to be used. And there is the Priest of Yawgmoth, the Invisible Man Altar again. Really cool to see. There's another poster boy. Oh, really nice. I mean, this deck, this is so much fun to play against. These cards just look so nice. Playing a strip mine. I wonder if I'm going to strip myself. No, I'm so far ahead with the lands now. There is an animate wall that I talked about, and it can just fly over here and deal 4 damage because of the fortified area. That means it's going to 16, and I believe that that's enough. Let's see. Yeah, that's exactly enough to kill him if I find a Sword of the Ages. For now, just attacking. Going to 12. And Park, I think Park needs a disc. A disc would really save him right now. Just blow up everything and start over again. I think that's the best decision. Finding a Library of Alexandria, playing a disc. There's a disenchant. Oh, I'm sorry, Park. I think that's kind of it's not the end yet, but it's so close to the end now. Because even if you have a second disc in hand, you need a full turn. Going to 8 here. He needs another disc right now, and then he can just survive. He's not finding it. Attacking, going to 4 here. Can I find a sword? I cannot, but then I can just kill him with my wall of swords. Finding the disc, but it's too little, too late. Untapping, and that's it, that's game, and that's the match. That means a 2-0 win for me, or I should say a 0-2. Wow, Park, thank you so much for playing. And actually, if you like to see another game, we played a third game after this, so if you like to see another game, just stay where you are, because we're going to game number 3. Game number 3. And I guess I've already won the match, but when you're playing nice games like this, it's always fun to kind of play that third game. Also, it's nice to note that Park is in LA and I'm in Amsterdam, so there's a huge time difference here. With me, it's early morning. I'm just, you know, chilling with a cup of coffee, and for Park, it's pretty late in the evening. And, this doesn't look like chilling at all, Park. I was just complimenting your deck, and now you're mind-twisting me again. So, twisting me here for 4... Oh, look at that. And there you can see some new cards in my build, by the way. That Wrath of God, I haven't had a chance to actually play it out so far. Maybe that seems kind of strange when you're playing with a lot of creatures or walls and then playing a Wrath of God, but I just noticed it works really well with the Sword of the Ages, that if you cannot kill him, but you can really get him behind, really on life total, like do a hit of 10 or 12 or 13 damage, and then having that Wrath to deal with his creatures afterwards, and maybe a resurrection for your Legionnaire, then you're kind of set, you know, that's kind of the dream. Playing a Mishra's Factory passing turn, so Park now taking a damage from his own Mana Vault. I wonder if he's going to play out another land. He's deciding not to. And playing a Wolf, Keltrops, and passing turns, going to 18. So we kind of have a land tax standoff here. But it's fine by me, because he's still taking damage. Now also from Mishra's Factory, but also from the Mana Vault. That means he's going down to 15. So I'm kind of forcing him now to play out a land. And there's an anime death. Very cool. And I like this. Very cool. So now that means he's got a 2/5 flying wall. And let's see if I can find a disenchant. And I can't. Just passing turn here. And Park going to 14. Still taking damage from the Mana Vault. And now he is playing land number 3. Playing the Xenic Poltergeist. And unfortunately, you cannot use the Xenic Poltergeist to animate your Mana Vault and then let your Mana Vault untap itself, because it says it still keeps its original abilities, and part of that is that it doesn't untap during your untap step. So just making it a creature doesn't really change that. That's one of the things we discussed. And as you can see, this is his Hunchback of the Notre Dame altar with Esmeralda there hiding behind the table. And there's the fortified area. And fortified area only counts for my walls, so that means that Park's Wall of Swords is not getting the bonus. And we're kind of at a standstill here for a while now, but Park is taking damage from the Mana Vault already on 13. Oh, this is cool. Oh, this is cool. Cormus Bell, that's the word I'm looking for. And Cormus Bell makes all the swamps 1/1 black creatures. And the fact that they're black is very important. So if he can play out a Bad Moon, which I don't think is in the deck, but let me know if it is. Maybe I missed it. Then he has 2/2 creatures. I still want to build something with Cormus Bell and Bad Moons. But, I mean, he is taking a big risk here. If I can find my Wrath of God, that would just be brutal. He would lose 3 swamps and his creatures here. Am I gonna... No, for a moment there, I thought I was going to play a Wrath of God. I'm not. I'm actually playing a Wall of Swords and passing turn here. I also have that second Mishra's Factory on the board. So we're really like building up stuff here. And I wonder if Park's going to untap. He's not going to untap his Mana Vault. So he must have something other in hand. Another thing that Park can do, by the way, is make his Cormus Bell into a 4/4 creature with the Xenic Poltergeist. But remember, my Wall of Swords is a 4/5 because of the fortified area bonus. Drawing a card here, unable to activate my land tax. And now I have more lands than Park even. Playing a second fortified area. That means that my Wall of Swords is now a 5/5. And now Park is choosing to untap his Mana Vault, so no longer taking the damage. And I wonder what he can do here. I kind of feel that Cormus Bell is a very cool play, but also like a super risky play. And it's not really helping him much at this point. Playing another planes, meaning I have 6 mana, so I could cast a sword if I have one, a Sword of the Ages. I've actually decided to play a Felden's Cane main board. But I think I decided that after this game, I'm just constantly trying to tweak the brick in the wall deck. Because that Felden's Cane can just be really useful to get my Sword of the Ages back and also get all the creatures back that I then sacrificed. And let's see what my opponent can do here. Not much, it seems. Passing turn. Playing another land. I've got so much land. I wish there was a white fireball and I could just... I don't know. Heaven's Beam or something, and I could just use all that white mana. There's Alola. I don't think Park has enough mana ever cards in hand now to draw. Playing another basic, and look at that, an animate wall, and that means I have a 5/5 wall here. And a disenchant. Ooh, this is painful for Park here. Disenchant over the animate dead. That means that I can attack it with a 5/5 wall of sorts. And remember that first game, or the second game, I should say, that I won as well with by animating a wall of sorts. I think wall of sorts is such a good creature. And obviously, playing with enchant creatures is super risky because you're setting yourself up for 2-for-1. And there's a Demonic Tutor. I mean, if Bark would have some terrors in his sideboard, maybe, hey, just play a main. He could easily get a nice 2-for-1 here, just taking out my Wall of Swords. Look at that. There's a disc, but that's going to be super risky because when he activates the disc, it means that he kills all his swamps because they're now creatures because of the Cormorant Spell. Wow. Oh, this is interesting. Playing a Priest of Yawgmoth, and he can use that to actually sacrifice his Cormorant Spell. So I think next turn is going to be super interesting. If there will be a next turn, of course, for Park, because I can hit him for 5 or get him down to 2. And it looks like that's all I can do now. Not finding a disenchant, so this turn is going to be super interesting. What can he do? Untap, upkeep. And I remember that we kind of discussed this scenario by discussing what's the best thing for him to do. Because he wants to activate his disc so that he doesn't get any damage from the Mana Vault. But that's not possible. It's on the stack. So he kind of has to untap the Mana Vault. And then we were saying, or I was saying, maybe you can use the mana from the Cormorant Spell by sacking the Cormorant Spell with your priest, untapping the Mana Vault. There you see the dice for 4. Untapping the Mana Vault to untap, then activate. But now he has 4 mana from the Suchi left. And we're actually playing, I haven't mentioned this yet because you don't really notice it, but we're actually playing EC because Park is playing with 2 Strip Mines in his deck. And of course with Fallen Empire. So this is an EC matchup. So that means we're playing with Mana Burn. So he's on 2, but he needs to spend those 4 mana that he got from the Suchi. And I think we're doing it again because he wants to use that mana for the Suchi in his main phase and not in his upkeep. Okay, so I guess he's now taking a damage from the Mana Vault. Then he's drawing a card. Then he's probably using the... Yeah. Second with the Yawgmoth, gaining 4 mana. But how is he going to use that mana? So he's 4 black mana now. Destroying everything with his disc. Having 4 black mana floating, 4 colorless mana floating. Maybe he has a Drain Life now. That would be pretty cool. Playing a Greed, which is funny because he doesn't have any life to draw cards, but oh man, he's playing a Greed. That means he's got 1 colorless left and 3 black. You can kind of see the dice there in the corner. This is a very complicated situation, and I remember we were discussing this, playing Order of the Ebon Hand here, playing an anime debt, but he still has 1 colorless mana and he's only on one life. So if he gets Mana Burn for 1, he's dead. And oh, he's doing it! Yes! I mean, of course I remember, but it's fun to look back at this because, I mean, I remember us discussing it and trying to find a way that he could not kill himself. That was kind of our main goal. Playing a Wall of Light here, a wall from my sideboard. Protection from blacks are very useful, obviously, against this deck. But what a play here by Park Goldfield. Staying alive, not dying. And now what he needs now is a Drain Life to kind of get back into this game. you know, build up some life, because he, you know, he knows he's playing against this crazy wall of sword combination. And I haven't played a single wall of swords in this game, so they're still in my deck. And paying two here, using Wolf Keltrops. Doesn't make a big change on the current board state. Of course, one animate wall would kind of kill Park right now, because I could play it on my Wall of Swords. But I've passed turn already, and Park is playing... Oh, we've seen that Invisible Man a lot. Another Priest of Yawgmoth. The priest that just saved his life earlier. Or actually, I should say saved his swamps. Animate wall, end of game. End of game. Park, I'm sorry, man. But it was great to play against your deck. It was so much fun. I love your alters. If you ever want to play again, or if you ever have any other alter deck, let me know. I'm always open for a rematch. Showing here my Legionnaire. Unfortunately, I couldn't play it this time. But fun games. Thank you, Park, and what a flavorful, cool deck you have built. Now, if you've enjoyed this episode of Timmy Talks, you can help me and help my channel out by subscribing to the channel if you haven't done so already. Leave a comment. Let me know what you think of those crazy plays, and if you think Spirit Link should stay in my Brick in the Wall deck. If you want to see more old school magic, you can click on the videos that are appearing right now on the screen, or of course you can check out the channel itself. For now, thank you for watching, and see you next time.